Hello and welcome to Bible Study with Friends. I'm here with my friend Stan Ford. I'm Len Allen, your host, and it's exciting to have you here. We are in the book of Mark. We are continuing on in our Bible study. Stan and I, although thousands of miles apart, we are together in spirit and on technology.
Yes.
So, yeah. Glad, and you're here with us too. If this has been a blessing to you, by the way, please subscribe and hit the like button, and you hit that little bell, and every time I post this every week, you'll get a notification that there's a new one available. And we're also doing this on a number of other books and subjects in the Bible, so you can come to the YouTube channel check out some of those other Bible studies verse by verse. Yeah. Well, good morning, Stan.
Good morning.
It's morning for us, but they could be watching us on YouTube at, you know, at 10 o'clock at night, so we don't know.
Yeah.
But glad you're all with us, and glad you're with me this morning, Stan.
Yes, I am too.
We left off last week. We're in the book of Mark. Now, remember, the theme of Mark is presenting Christ as an action hero servant, the servant hero. And it's being written for the Roman mind, for the Roman of the day, for the Gentile, who didn't know anything about the Old Testament, anything about anything, but understood his world as it existed in that day. And this book is really written to him, to that person. Him or her. We are in the New American Standard, but you can follow along in any version. That shouldn't be any kind of a problem for you. And we left off last week at chapter 2, verse 17.
Yes.
And this is the up in verse about verse 13. The opposition up to this point, the first two chapters have been kind of an introduction to who Jesus is and the introduction of the hero, his baptism, his temptation, his call of his disciples. He's starting to establish his authority. Demons are obeying him. Disease is obeying him, etc. But now, in chapter 2, starting at verse 13, opposition begins. Now, this is interesting because we have the Lord just two chapters into his ministry. He's just started his ministry, and almost immediately, we have opposition. Yeah. Now, that's important for you and I because when we're sharing our faith and living our faith, what do we invariably run into?
Opposition.
Yeah. And I've talked to many Christians over the years who go, oh man, you know, at work or in my family or with friends, you know, I'll say something and they just come at me. They attack me. Well, welcome to the club.
Yeah.
Because here we have Jesus Christ himself who is ministering. He's just presenting the gospel and ministering to people, healing people, and immediately opposition comes. So we shouldn't be surprised when opposition comes in our lives, right?
Right.
Right. Well, let's listen. Let's go into the verse. Let me share our screen. And we're down here starting at verse 18. And let's read. I've got 18 going into the rest of the chapter on the next page here. But let's just begin to read this. Now, what we're seeing here is the opposition is starting. Up here in verse 13, I've got a note. The initial opposition to the hero. And initially, we have opposition because of Christ's social life. Remember, he had a party. He called Matthew, and Matthew called all of his friends, and they had a party, they had a dinner party, where Christ was there, and he was ministering to them and sharing with them. And immediately, people started to say, hey, why are you hanging out with those people? Up here in verse 15, the tax collectors and sinners. The Pharisees were there, and they were saying, hey, how come you're hanging out? How come your social life is you're spending time with those people instead of the religious elite.
Yeah.
And Jesus, of course, responds with that. Why? He says, I did not come to call those who think they're righteous, the righteous, but I've come for those who call themselves and consider themselves sinners. And the first thing in the gospel, when we hear the good news of Christ, that he died for our sins on the cross, the first thing we have to do in coming to terms with Christ and asking Christ to come into our lives as our Savior and our Lord is to come to the point of admitting that we're sinners.
Yeah.
And until we admit we're sinners, we say, well, I want Christ to be part of my life as kind of a religious thing. And I'm going to try Christianity out a little bit. So I'm going to try going to church and those kinds of things. No. Unless we can come to a point where we can say, Jesus died for sinners. I'm a sinner. Jesus wants to hang out with me.
Yeah.
Then we're on our way to becoming a believer and following Christ. Now, the second part that we see, so that he had opposition because of his social life, but here we're starting to see opposition because of his spiritual life, and opposition specifically because he was not a ceremonial guy. He was not a religion for the purpose of the ritual kind of guy.
Yeah.
And he's going to make a point about that in a second. So we see this right here in verse 18. John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and they came and said to him. Now, there's a couple things here. Fasting was a typical first century Jewish practice. It was a religious ritual to like meditation and those kinds of things to get supposedly focused on God. But it became a kind of a ritual to say, hey, look at me. I'm fasting today. Aren't I spiritually good?
Yeah. I was going to say the Pharisees really took a lot of pride in that fact of the fasting,
not pride in what it accomplished in their spiritual lives,
right?
Pride in the fact they were doing it.
Doing it for a show,
That would be like somebody saying, well, I go to church. Isn't that good that I go to church?
Yeah.
Well, it's not about going to church and doing the ritual. It's about what church is doing with us and for us.
Yes.
And in our lives. So here he runs into this. The very first question, a couple of interesting things. Notice these little stars where it says,
yes,
came and said, and those verbs are in the past tense. John's disciples and Pharisees were fasting, and they came and said to him. That little star is the way the translators in the New American Standard are helping us understand a Greek way of writing. And that is, this is a narrative, this is a story, and the author, Mark, John Mark, and Peter is dictating to him. But John Mark wants to bring us as the readers, he wants to bring the Gentile reader right into the action. So these little stars mean that in the Greek, this is written in the present tense. So in the Greek, this would read, John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and they come to him and say to him. So this is to bring us into, this is happening, all right?
Yeah.
And this is just a little thing, but it's this idea of action again. He's writing about this action, and he's using this term immediately, and the term and. In fact, it starts this right away. And so to get us into the action, we use this term. So he comes, the Pharisees come and say to him, why do John's disciples, John the Baptist, now these guys are no fans of John the Baptist, but John the Baptist is an ascetic. He wears camel skins, and he eats locusts, and he's out doing the baptism for repentance, calling for repentance. And his fast was to fast for the sake of repentance. But the Pharisees say, hey, they're going through the motions that we're going through. They're fasting, and we're fasting. And then he says, then they ask the question, why do John's disciples and the disciples and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast. Now that tells us something, that the followers of Jesus at this point were not fasting, and they were not going through this religious ritual of fasting. And Jesus said to them, while the bridegroom is with them, the attendants, he uses the idea of a wedding party. And he says, look, when the bridegroom is there and you're throwing the party, you don't say, oh, no, I am abstaining. You enjoy the party with the bridegroom while the bridegroom is there.
Yeah.
That make a lot of sense?
Yeah, it does.
All right. Well, let's go to the next page and pull up here, and because that continues on. Let me pull up to 20. So Jesus is continuing on with this. Explanation and an answer to their question, why aren't you guys going through these ceremonies? And he says, the day will come when the bridegroom, me, has been taken away. Now, this is the first time we get a glimpse that Jesus has the plan and knows the plan of God to die and to be gone.
Yeah, that's interesting when he said those three words, is taken away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The bridegroom, he doesn't leave. He is taken away.
Oh, yeah.
And that kind of smacks of prophecy, that Jesus knows how this ministry is going to end. And he knows God's plan. Of course, he's God.
Yeah.
So of course, he knows it. But this is the first time, and it's early on. I mean, we're in chapter 2. And he's already hinting that there will be a time when he's going to be gone. And the disciples will, at that point, be interested in being more spiritually aware. And that's what the purpose of fasting was. It wasn't just a ceremony. So he says, hey, the day will come when they'll fast. But right now, they aren't going to fast. And then he says something very interesting. I want you to read 21 and 22 for us.
No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear results. No one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will bust the skins, and the wine is lost, and the skins as well. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins.
Now, in answering their question about this religious practice of fasting, Jesus uses two. This is not one metaphor. This is two different metaphors, two different examples of what he's trying to do and what he has come to earth to do. So the first one is this sowing metaphor.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if you do much sowing. I don't do a whole lot. But let's say you have a pair of jeans that you've washed and worn and washed and worn, and you know how they shrink and they get nice and worn, but you get tear in it, so you decide to patch the tear. You don't go and get a brand new piece of denim and sew on there and then wash it. What's going to happen? The brand new piece is going to shrink. The older piece is already shrunk, so it's not going to shrink anymore. So you have a shrinking on the old piece that's already shrunk, and so it tears even worse.
Yeah.
So let's put this. What is he talking about with his religious teaching that Jesus is trying to get across here?
I believe it could be he's trying to teach them that the old law is not going to be coherent. The words I'm looking for, to go along with what he's bringing.
To coincide, yeah, okay.
Yeah, to do it.
So he's the new thing that's come to patch what's wrong. Religion at this point, the Jewish religion at this point, had become ritual, just like a lot of religion is for a lot of people today. It's ritual.
Yeah.
And he is saying, I'm coming with a new thing. My new thing isn't meant to patch up your old thing. It's a new thing, right?
Yeah.
Now, he uses that example of this new thing immediately with another metaphor. That's this wineskin. Now,
yeah,
the way a wineskin would work, when they put wine in and it fermented, they put it in a wineskin, literally a skin.
Yeah.
And as it fermented, the gases and everything would expand out the skin, and it turned into wine, and it aged there. And then you drank it from the wineskin. You poured it out into your vessels. So the wineskin was stretched, and the wine became wine, and it was consumed. Well, now if you would have put new wine before it's fermented into that one that's already stretched, just like the pair of pants was already stretched.
Yeah.
When it starts to ferment, it's going to burst the skins, because the skins are already stretched out and set.
Yeah.
So Christ is trying to get across the point here. I haven't come to just give more religious ritual or additional religious ritual or patch up what's wrong with your religious ritual. I have come to bring a new faith, a new thing, a new covenant. And we'll find out that's later. And it's not meant to try to patch up what you guys are doing. It's meant to be embraced as something new.
Yeah. And the two is not going to intertwine with each other. There's no way.
Coincide. Right.
Yeah.
And people today, there are people who say, well, I'm Christian and I've accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, but I'm still going to practice the Old Testament, the law. And I'm still going to obey the law. That was like the Judaizers who said you become a Christian, but to become a Christian, you first have to become a Jew and obey the law, and then you become a Christian and continue to obey the law.
Yeah.
And that is not the case. This is not meant to bolster up the Old Testament law of works. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, Paul writes a little bit about this. Flip over in your Bible to Romans chapter 7, verse 6.
Okay.
This newness of the Christian faith, Paul talks about in Romans 6. It's a completely different author, but he's going to give the same kind of idea about the law. Go ahead and read chapter 7, verse 6.
It says, but now we have been released from the law, having died to that by which we were bound, so that we serve in newness of the spirit and not in the oldness of the letter.
Okay, and that's this idea of we're a new thing. We're not in the old wineskin of the law.
Yeah.
We're in a new wineskin, okay? That is meant to grow with us in our faith and not try to fit into the spirit of the old law of practicing things, practicing works in order to be achieved as, to be noticed as righteous.
Yeah.
This is new. This is faith. And Jesus immediately said, you guys are attacking my spiritual life. Hey, my spiritual life is about people. It isn't about ritual.
Yeah.
And this is new. And as long as I'm here, it's going to be new, and my followers are going to be celebrating with joy that I'm with them. And then I'm going to be taken away, and then he hasn't talked about this yet, but later he's going to talk about, and then I will come back so that your joy will be restored.
Yeah.
Now, I want to do in the next 5 to 6 minutes, I want to talk about the rest of this here. From 23 down to the end of the chapter. Now, this is kind of interesting because we get, again, this action. So he's having this conversation with the Pharisees, and it happened. So in other words, the action continues.
Yeah.
And it happened that he was passing through the grain fields on the Sabbath. He was Jesus, okay? And
he's
walking through the grain fields with his followers on the Sabbath. And his disciples began to make their way along while picking the heads of grain. Now, they're not stealing, because what happened as a cultural thing in the day was, when you picked a field, a grain field, You left. You didn't pick it clean. You left some so that the poor, the homeless,
yes,
could come and get some sustenance.
Yeah.
So it was a way of kind of community. It was a food kitchen.
Yeah.
A food pantry of the day. And so they're walking along, and they're walking through a grain field, and they start to reach down, and they pick up some grain, and they get the grain, and they can pop it in and start to eat it. The Pharisees were saying, in verse 24, the Pharisees were saying to him, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? So immediately, they're back to the law and the Sabbath and the rules. Now, the law, the original Ten Commandments said, you'll keep the Sabbath for the Lord. You'll meditate on the Lord. You'll do these sorts of things. It's not the Sabbath. But they had added a whole bunch of rules. You couldn't do this, and you couldn't do this, and you can do this, and you can't do that. And you can, all kinds of rules. They're really talking about the rules of man, the rules that they had added. It's like the Ten Commandments and then the 500 rules based on the Ten Commandments, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
And they were saying, now, there's something interesting happening here. What do you see in 23 and 24 about where were the Pharisees?
They must have been in the field where Jesus was passing through.
They had to be.
Yeah.
They were literally following him along.
Yeah.
Watching him.
Yeah.
And they're following him, watching him, so that they can see if he trips up. And then they can report back to Jerusalem, the head of where the temple was, and they can get a sanction against him, as a heretic.
Yeah, they're trying to build their case against him.
That's right. They're following him along. They're right there.
Yeah.
Now, they were saying to him. So as they're walking through the grain, and one of the disciples picks up a piece of grain and pops it in his mouth. Oh, that's work. That's harvesting. Okay. It'd be like saying that lifting the spoon from the bowl to your mouth is work. That's an action. You can't,
Yeah.
They were saying, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? Now, that's not the original law. That's the law that they have come up with.
Yeah.
And he said, this is continuing action. And there's that word, that's the little star again.
Yeah.
The way this is written. And he says to them, okay, so the reader are right there with him.
Yeah.
And he says to them, have you never read what David did? He's got to explain a little bit, because if he's talking to Jews, he says, you remember what David did with the showbread? The Jews would go, yeah, we remember. But he's talking to Gentiles, so he's got to explain this a little bit. He's talking to the Pharisees, who are Jews, but he's talking to them and explaining to us Gentile readers. So he says, you remember what David did when he was in need and he and his companions became hungry. Now for us, there's a reference over into 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel over in our cross references, over right over in here. 1 Samuel chapter 2, or chapter 21, verse 1, where he's running, David is running, and he has to run for his life from Saul.
Yeah.
And he doesn't take any food with him. And he's got some friends. And so the first place he goes to is the temple. And he asks the priest if there's some bread that they can have. And the priests say, well, here's some showbread. Now, this is not supposed to be for human consumption. It's for the Lord, offered to the Lord. And David says, I really need it to fulfill my role. And he takes the bread. Now, Mark has to explain that to us Gentile readers. So he says, how he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar. Abiathar is the high priest at the time, but mentions him. Abiathar, the high priest. Now, they knew who Abiathar was. As a good Jew, they would know the history. But he's explaining to us Gentiles. So Abiathar, the high priest, and ate the consecrated bread. And that is the consecrated bread being the loaves that were donated for the Lord, basically took out of the offering plate, so to speak.
Yeah.
And he ate the consecrated bread, which is not lawful for anyone to eat except the priest. Now, the Pharisees know that, but Mark is explaining to us hey, when David was in need, he came and he took bread and he ate it. It wasn't proper, quote, quote, proper to eat, but he ate it because he absolutely needed it for sustenance.
Yeah.
He was in need and he and his companions became hungry. And it wasn't lawful for anyone to eat except the priest. He also gave it to those who were with him. So he and the guys with him, and Jesus is going, me and the guys with me, if we're having, because we're hungry, we're having a little bit of a bite to eat on the Sabbath, it's no big deal. And then he says this in verse 27, and we're going to end here. Jesus said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Now, when in the Ten Commandments, the Sabbath was a day of rest. It was a day where you were supposed to rest from your work and concentrate on the Lord and just kind of worship and be with him. And it was not meant to be for man to serve the Sabbath, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And when it comes to law, it becomes a ritual. We got to serve that ritual.
Yeah.
And then that last verse, he says, the Sabbath, this is a concept. Hey, the Sabbath was not made for man to serve the Sabbath, but for the Sabbath to help man rest and focus.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, this is, starts to be the purpose of this festival of Sabbath, this celebration of Sabbath, was not to be a religious ceremony that we got to make sure we do it the right way and we, you know, all that stuff. But it's more for us to be blessed and refreshed and refocused on God. So it's meant to serve man, not be a set of rules. And for us Christians, we got to get to a point where we say that we got to get to a point where we're saying church isn't meant to be a set of rules that we have to go to. You have to dress a certain way. You have to be there at a certain, you have to go in the morning.
Yeah.
You can't go Saturday night. You got to go Sunday morning. You can't go in the afternoon. You have to go, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We got to be careful not to do this because our faith and Christ's teachings are not meant to make us serve them. They are for our benefit to serve us spiritually. And if that's why Jesus came.
Yeah. And if we're not careful, we're serving the ritual instead of
exactly right
serving Christ.
And that last verse, he says this very interesting thing. This is, again, the hero establishing his authority. And he says, hey, guys, he's talking to the Pharisees. He says, hey, guys, you know, the Sabbath wasn't meant for man to serve it, but it was meant to help man.
Yeah.
And I'm doing this to show you I am Lord.
Yeah.
I'm the governor. I'm the boss of the Sabbath.
Yeah. That's
so
great.
Immediately, he is establishing these credentials to this religious practicing, the religious ceremonial people who are really in the ritual. And I've heard people talk about, well, I like the Catholic Church, for example. I like to go to the Mass because I love that ritual. I love that ceremony. Yeah. And even big churches of other denominations, Protestant denominations, can be very high church. Lutheran, Presbyterian, even some Baptist churches can be very formal, dress a certain way. I remember. I was at a church one time where the board decided that it was proper only for the pastor to only preach in a white shirt and a tie and a jacket. But if he wore a tie and a jacket with a blue shirt, that was not rich. That was not religious. That was not spiritual. That's the case. We got to be really careful, folks.
Yeah.
Now we're at 31 minutes. We're finished with chapter 2. And it gives us something to think about. The Lord, Jesus Christ, is Lord over religious ceremony. And he is in charge. And we shouldn't put our religious ceremony as being higher than our relationship with Christ. The relationship with Christ comes first.
Yeah.
Then if we want to, for the sake of preference, if we prefer a certain kind of music or a certain kind of this or that and the other thing, as long as it's clear in our mind, this is not the faith, this is our preference. The faith is Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, Lord even of the Sabbath.
Yes. So,
Lord in his religious life, in his spiritual life, he is establishing his authority over his spiritual life, whether people don't like it or not. And we're going to see immediately in chapter 3, that word immediately, it shows up in verse 6 of chapter 3, by the way. Jesus is going to start to really separate himself from the religious people and bind himself to the people of faith. We're going to talk more about that next week. Comment, question, do you want to sum it up for us?
I think it's great. I think that we're, like you said, we need to be careful that we don't get the ceremonial things ahead of really serving and worshiping Christ. You know,
our focus should be on Jesus, not on the stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
I should be able to worship Christ in the middle of a concrete warehouse. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
And if I get two or three people together and we can worship the Lord together, so be it. I remember one time I was saying goodbye to some friends in Honolulu. They were flying out. I might not have seen them for many, many years. And I remember we just got together. There was about five of us. And we got together and we had communion together. We brought purposely. We just wanted to have communion together as our last time together.
Yeah.
And I remember sharing that with somebody that I had communion with, a group of believers at the International Airport in Honolulu. And they went, communion is only for church. You've got to have it in the church the first Sunday of the month, or it's got to be, you know, and you've got to have with the pastor has to do it, and you know, all and on and on and on. I said, "Which man? Who put these rules? Right?"
Yes, exactly.
That's not what communion was about. But anyway, let's end here. Thank you guys on YouTube and on podcast for listening and for viewing. Be sure to subscribe and to hit the like button. That really helps us with the YouTube algorithm. And hit the little bell, and you'll get notification when we do this. Post this next week. God bless you, and God bless you, Stan. Thanks for Bible study with friends. Thanks for being a friend. I have so few.
Thank you.
I don't know whether that means that you're somehow weird so that you're my friend, or I don't know. thanks for being friends, and thank you guys for viewing and for listening. God bless you. See you next week.